Fox News alert to Rome. We are watching the
bail would go up. We contacted the county again asking, did anybody else in the meeting hear this threat? And they said, you got to talk to the cops. Cops aren't commenting. And right now it seems to be this appraiser's word against Mrs. Hart's word about this charge, Megan.
Wow. All right, Trace. Thank you.
Okay.
Fox News alert to Rome. We are watching the chimney of the Sistine Chapel for a telltale puff of smoke. The results of the day's final vote for Pope could come any second. We are starting our second hour of America Live a little early today because we don't want to miss a moment. If this thing really actually does happen within the next 3 minutes, we want to make sure you see it. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Megyn Kelly. Look at the thousands of folks waiting anxiously on a rainy evening in St. Peter's Square. Look at them. I mean, think about that. You know, we see folks doing this for rock concerts and so on just to get tickets. And these folks are waiting for a different sort of rock star. Our next pope, who after he is elected, will be someone billions of people around the world will again continue to wait hours and hours just to catch a glimpse of. Never mind, perhaps lay hands on, perhaps hear from. Earlier today, we saw another vote, and that produced black smoke, which means no decision yet. Catholics worldwide are hoping to see white smoke, meaning the church does have a new spiritual leader, and it will tell us so much about the course of the church when we learn who that man will be. With the selection of the next pontiff all but imminent, what kinds of challenges will he have to confront, and what will we learn as soon as we learn the man's identity? Joining us live now from Rome, Father Gerald Murray from the Diocese of Fall River, Massachusetts, and the National Chaplain of Catholic Voices USA. Father, great to see you.
Good to be with you, Megan.
There's been a lot of talk in recent days about there are so-called reformists among the cardinals who would like to see a new pontiff who can sort of clean up the Vatican and take a focus on some of the scandals that have plagued the Catholic Church and focus on improving those situations versus some who want to see sort of a more traditional choice, somebody who might address those issues but would be more focused on combating secularism and so on. What do you think is likely to happen?
I think it's basically a question of both and. When we talk about reform, we're talking literally about shaping something up, putting it into shape again. And all the cardinals recognize, at least those who are non-Italians working in the Curia, that the functioning on the day-to-day basis of the Roman Curia needs to be improved. Also, there are a lot of other areas in which the church could do a better job in articulating the message. And so the cardinals all last week were talking about that, and I think whoever walks out on that balcony is going to walk out with a mandate from his brother cardinals, as well as their collaboration in trying to address these issues to bring the church up to shape and up to strength.
What would be the argument for going someone who is, as you say, inside the Curia? I can see the argument for going for somebody who's on the outside and not connected to any of the, you know, Vatican Bank scandal and the other issues that they've suffered. But what's the argument for going for somebody who's inside that inner circle?
If the cardinals vote to elect someone who's presently a member of the Curia, the reason for that would be they believe that he has the inside knowledge and the will and the courage to be able to reform it from within. If you were to take somebody who has no experience in the Roman Curia, it might be a little bit harder to carry out that reform and improvement that is needed. There are certain candidates, for example, like the Canadian Cardinal Mark Ouellette, who has a reputation already of being a great reformer, and he was an archbishop in Quebec City, and now he's come here, and what you've seen him do in the Congregation for Bishops here in the Vatican is something that's gotten many of the cardinals to ask, could he do that throughout the entire Vatican infrastructure?
So you're saying that most of these cardinals want to see some of these reforms. It's just a question of who they feel will be best to implement those reforms.
Yes, or at the same time, the one who could supervise the reforms being done. So what's happened here in Italy, they recognize the Pope can't be an organizational micromanager, but they want to trust his judgment that he would be able to surround himself with the types of collaborators who would be able to implement that type of reforming vision. And so for the first time, I think most reporters here in Rome have ever seen, in the Italian press, not only do they have the candidates for the papacy, but they have their guesswork as to who he would have as his Secretary of State, which combines the positions of foreign minister as well as chief of staff, because they recognize that the Pope can't delegate his preaching, he can't delegate celebrating the Mass and the sacraments, but he can delegate a lot of that shepherding and reform work that all of them are agreed needs to occur.
How do they find somebody? We talked about this a little yesterday, but you know, the Catholic Church has suffered in just anecdotally in terms of filling the pews in the Sunday masses and in terms of the growth of secularism. And that's such a huge challenge, not just to Catholicism, but to many more organized religions. I mean, how do you find somebody? Do you need someone charismatic? Do you need somebody likable as opposed to an academic who can speak to the masses and convince them that Catholicism is worthwhile?
Catholics believe that there's an inherent beauty and attraction in the faith. The problem sometimes is we don't make it beautiful and attractive. And we're just not talking about bishops and priests. We're talking about Catholic mothers and fathers sometimes, Catholic brothers and sisters, the typical parishioners who would attend Mass on a given Sunday. And so what they're looking for is not necessarily someone who is going to, at an intellectual level, show some of the holes in secularist logic, but someone who can inspire people that the faith makes us joyful, the faith brings us something that our hearts are made for, that we don't often receive from any of the other sources. And so I think you're going to see walking out on that balcony someone who clearly has the intellectual chops to teach, but also someone who has the personal chops to inspire people to give Catholicism a second look if they've born and fled, or at the same time, if they're a strong Catholic, someone who can make them stronger so that they're able to communicate the joy that's supposed to flow from our faith to their friends, family, neighbors, co-workers, fellow students at school.
Born and fled. I like that. I hadn't heard that, Father, but there are a lot of Catholics who would describe themselves that way. I want to ask you about the two so-called front runners, and we don't really know what's happening inside the conclave, but they say that they are the pro-reform cardinal, who is Angelo Scola of Italy, and then there's the more sort of Curia insider, who is Brazil's Odilo Scherer. Any idea, I mean, how, we talk about one as sort of the pro-reform guy and one is sort of the insider, but how different are they? I mean, how vastly different would their approaches be?
What they would share in common is so much greater than what would distinguish them. Cardinal Scola, who was my teacher here in Rome, is an absolutely brilliant academic who is a human brainstorm. He'll come up with lots of ideas, but the questions that cardinals will have about him is, how will he be in implementing those ideas? Cardinal Odilo Scherer from Sao Paulo in Brazil, he has a reputation for being far more methodical in his implementation. And so while Cardinal Scola would have many more ideas about what would need to be reformed, Cardinal Scherer might have fewer ideas, but at the same time, that greater series of mechanisms and protocols to be able to go step by step to bring those needed reforms in the practices of the Roman Curia, especially the speed with which they work, as well as to clean out some of the areas that don't function as they need to. Cardinal Francis George of Chicago last week was saying publicly that one of the issues is when letters are sent in, for example, from Chicago requiring a quick response, a lot of the times that takes months rather than days. And so to speed up that whole apparatus, Cardinal Scherer, for example, and many others would have the know-how of exactly how you'd be able to improve those protocols on a day-to-day basis.
Father, I called you Gerald Murray because that was in the prompter, and I know Gerald Murray, and you were too polite to correct me. But you are Father Roger Landry. And before I let you go, we have smoke. It appears gray. It's whitish. Will we hear the bells ring immediately, Father?
I anticipate, based on what we saw earlier, that is definitely not black smoke. Look for Cardinal Angelo Scola to come out on that balcony.
Father, the smoke is white, and it appears we have a new pope as the crowds go wild in St. Peter's Square in celebration. It is rather unambiguously white. One hesitates to say because you don't want to get ahead of yourself, but you can see the square. The folks in the square feel the same as we do, that is white smoke coming out of the chimney in Vatican City. And your opinion is what on that, sir?
My opinion is that is clearly white smoke compared to the type of dark smoke that we saw yesterday afternoon as well as this morning. So I anticipate we're going to hear those words, Annuncio Vobis Gaudium Magnum, Habemus Papam, in the matter of about 45 minutes.
What is happening inside of the Vatican? Yes, as the bells ring aloud and infiltrate the square outside of the Vatican, you can hear the joyous shouts and cheers of the faithful watching what is clearly white smoke come out of the chimney. Those cardinals have done their job, and at least 77 of the 115 have voted in unison for one man to become the next leader of the Catholic Church. Let's just listen for a minute. Father Roger Landry, you can feel the happiness and exuberance of the folks live in Rome as they now know, as the world does, that we have a new pope. Inside the Vatican, we are being told, folks, that this is what has happened. Once a cardinal has been elected, the master of liturgical ceremonies enters the Sistine Chapel. The senior cardinal will ask of the newly elected pope, "Do you accept your election as supreme pontiff?" Assuming the cardinal says, "I accept," the senior cardinal then asks, "By what name do you wish to be called?" Then that information will be entered on a formal document. It is at that point that the white smoke pours out of the Sistine Chapel chimney and the bells of St. Peter's toll. So we believe that has happened, and the cardinal who has been elected has accepted the position. The new pope, we believe at this moment, is changing into his papal white cassock, and one by one, we believe the cardinals right now would be approaching him to swear their obedience. Moments from now, we will meet the new Pope, and you will hear the announcement, Habemus Papam, Latin for we have a Pope, and he will be introduced to the world in Latin and deliver his first words as Pope. It will happen moments from now. As you can hear, they have official business to take care of inside the Vatican, but the celebration goes on outside in St. Peter's Square. And look at the smiles on the folks' faces as they continue to celebrate. We're going to pause for one moment to let our Fox stations join us.
And good evening from Rome. I'm Shepard Smith. It's 12 minutes past 7 o'clock, and tonight we have a Pope. The white smoke began to rise from the Sistine Chapel just about 3, maybe 4 minutes ago, and by the thousands, people in St. Peter's Square, as the bells rang overhead, began to scream in celebration. It is a cold and rainy night. It has rained all day long, and thousands upon thousands have filled the streets waiting for the news that we have a Pope, and it has now come. They have not announced who the Pope is or from whence cometh the cardinal who will be the Pope. All we know is that the 115 cardinals who gathered here for the first day of the conclave yesterday, on their fifth ballot of the 2 days, were able to reach 77 votes for one of the 115 who walked in here as a cardinal and will come to the balcony at some point in this evening as the new Pope, the new Bishop of Rome, the leader of 1.2 billion Catholics around the world. In just a little while, the cardinal from France, who is actually who will be leading tonight, his name is Jean-Louis Taron. He's the head of the Curia, and he will come to the balcony where you see the familiar red curtains. And when he does so, he'll announce, we have a Pope, and he'll introduce who that Pope is. And actually, he'll read the Pope's first name in Latin, and from that, we'll be able to figure out who the Pope is. Robert Moynihan is with us. He's the founder of InsideTheVatican.com. And, sir, it's the moment for which Catholics have been waiting since we learned of the resignation of Pope Benedict XVI. The front runner, it was our understanding, would be the cardinal from Milan.
Angelo Scola has been considered the front runner. Shep, we don't know.
But he was considered the front runner.
Absolutely. If he comes out, it won't be a big surprise. He was very close to Cardinal Ratzinger. He was the Patriarch of Venice, then the Archbishop of Milan, considered to be the front runner in Italian. However, we don't know, Shep. They could be surprising us.
And one thing that we do know is they had the afternoon session voting yesterday, then two votes this morning, and two votes this afternoon. In 2005, when we stood in this exact same spot, and Benedict XVI, Cardinal Ratzinger, was elected Pope. It happened in the afternoon session, just as it did today, but on the first vote of the afternoon session. The common thinking is always, whoever the front runner would be elected in the first day or so. Otherwise, they would have gone later in the ballots, but we'll know soon enough. Tonight, as the rains fall and the bells ring and the flags wave and the horns honk, the one thing that is of absolute certainty, the Catholic Church has a new leader. And now to begin the work of bringing in more people and spreading the gospel. That is, of course, the primary job of the Catholic Church. They want to fill the pews on Sundays, and they want to make sure that the church is run properly from here at the Vatican and around the world. And Megyn Kelly in New York soon will know who the new Pope is.
It's an exciting moment here, Shepard, as it is around the world for not just the 1.2 billion Catholics who are waiting to hear who their new spiritual leader is, but for those who respect religion and respect what it stands for and the importance of it in so many people's lives. Joining me now by phone is Stephen White. He's a fellow in the Catholic Studies program at the Ethics and Public Policy Center. And Stephen, your thoughts on the relatively quick selection of our next Pope.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me on, Megan. Well, who knows? We've heard the name Angelo Scola mentioned, but we really don't know what's happened inside the Sistine Chapel other than that we have a new Pope.
Does it say anything about the man's popularity, the man's acceptability to the other cardinals, that it happened relatively quickly.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, it's unlikely that after this short period of time that the person chosen would have been a controversial choice or even sort of a compromised choice. This seems to be a man who a quick consensus was built around, and it only took, looks like, 5 votes, and they had him picked.
Would that suggest to you that it was, and of course this is all, you know, reading the tea leaves, we don't know, but would it suggest to you that it was likely, it is likely, one of the men who we were describing as front runners?
Yeah, I mean, I think as Father Landry said earlier, I mean, look for Angelo Scola to walk out on the balcony. If it's not him, that wouldn't be shocking. But again, if he does come out, that's no surprise either.
Stephen, I was talking with the viewers earlier about what's likely going on inside the Vatican right now. The newly elected Pope would have already indicated his agreement to take the position, and we are told would be putting on his white papal vestment now and getting ready to come out and address the crowd. Is that likely what's happening inside at this moment?
Yeah, that's what's happening. But what they're probably doing right now, actually, is stopping in the chapel before the Blessed Sacrament to pray. The Pope, the new Pope, and his cardinals will stop before he comes out on the loggia and is announced to the world. He and his brother cardinals will go in and pray, a prayer of thanksgiving, a prayer of guidance as he begins his new ministry. So they'll have a moment of quiet prayer before he comes out, and you know, the cheering crowds greet him, and people watch from all over the world.
Thanksgiving and guidance, 2 things I'm sure he's experiencing and wanting right now. Stephen, stand by if you would. Don't leave us, because you've been so helpful to all of us here at Fox over the past few days. I want to bring in John Moody, who is author of Pope John Paul II, a biography, and also executive vice president and executive editor here at Fox News. And what a moment, John.
It's always a magical moment, Megan. I can remember back in 2005 when we were waiting to see who would succeed John Paul II. And there were so many who thought that it would be Cardinal Ratzinger, and indeed it was, but the excitement is still there no matter what.
It's just, it's so hopeful. You get the same feeling as you get at a wedding or on the birth of a child. It's just something that's hopeful for the future about a new page in history and what could possibly be for the world's Catholics and the faithful.
That's right. And the Catholic Church, it must be said, knows how to put on pageantry.
Yeah, that's one thing we know as Catholics.
You know, it is perhaps the only major faith in the world that elects a leader this way, in secret, and that there's so much anticipation and no sureness in it. The Church of England, of course, it's the next king or queen of England, but in the Catholic Church, it's a mystery, and they like it that way.
And as we watch the folks in the square, they don't know who it is any more than we know who it is, but they feel jubilant just at the election that there is a new leader, that he will be coming out right here moments from now, and that we will all learn together simultaneously who that man is, and his life has just changed forever.
His life probably changed several years ago when he became a priest, but you're absolutely right. This is certainly the highlight of any cleric's career or aspirations for it. I can remember when John Paul II, the former Cardinal Karol Wojtyła, came out, and they announced his name in Latin, and nobody knew who he was. He wasn't in any of the sheets. Nobody had any prep notes for him, and the people in the crowd started to say, il Polacco, the Pole,
the
it's
Pole.
The Pole they've selected. And when he came out with that lovely smile and those crinkly eyes, and then began a little bit of self-deprecation and said, I'm sorry, I don't speak your language. And then he stopped and said, our language
right.
Very clearly. And everybody just loved him right away.
And that's, I mean, that was the first time in how many hundreds of years that they had gone with a non-Italian?
I believe it was almost 600 years.
Yeah, okay, so that was the first time. And then we had a German pope with then Cardinal Ratzinger.
Right.
And now we don't know. They could be going back to an Italian, if it is Scola, or perhaps somebody from Latin America. We're not sure yet.
Well, as we said, you know, these mysteries are intended to be mysterious. I don't think it's any mystery at all that the Italians would like to claim the papacy back.
Yeah.
They had it for so many years, and it's a little bit like the America's Cup. You know, they figure it belongs to them, and they want to get it back.
But Scola, if it's Scola, we don't know. Look at the smile. Well, look at this beautiful woman.
And it's genuine. The smiles are genuine.
You can see it, and people bringing their children out, and why wouldn't they to witness history? It's It's something, I mean, it's the same reason you bring your child to an inauguration of a president. It's history in the making, and this is going to be our 266th pope, and the very first one was appointed by Jesus, so it's a pretty good lineage.
It's a very good lineage to go by, and to your point, I mean, I just think that the joy that you're seeing in there now, yes, tomorrow, you know, they might get back and not like each other, these people in the crowd anymore, and they might have to go back to their regular lives, but right now is a moment, not just magical on earth, but it's a moment of connecting with God in a way that we can't do very often.
Right, right. It's a moment. Look, and I'm amazed to see the number of young people in the crowd too, John. I mean, the Catholic Church has struggled to reach out to the younger demographic, and yet look at the enthusiasm and the smiles and the joy in the faces of these young women and men, girls and boys too, not just children, but, you know, 12, 14-year-olds who are out there in that square.
Well, you know, the great thing about this is that the young people in that square have expectations now, and suddenly they have hope and hopefulness, and of course, it's the greatest sin in the world to disappoint people like that. You know, as Jesus said, you know, suffer not the little children to come unto me. He knew what he was talking about, and this is one of those moments when the next pope has a chance to live up to all those expectations.
Now, he's in there right now. He's going to speak. He's going to speak momentarily, just trying to listen out with one ear to hear if we're missing anything or not, I don't think. He's going to speak momentarily. Would most of these men have a few remarks written, or will this be extemporaneous? What do you think?
I'll bet every one of them, including the next pope, will put his hand on a Bible and say, no, I never expected it to be me. But then again, they probably have something in their pocket, a little bit of crib notes, or something shorthand. Probably the way an Oscar winner might come out and say, oh, no, I never expected this, but I would like to thank the following people.
Right, right. Let's hope they don't repeat, Anne Hathaway, it came true.
Well, let's hope for that, yes.
All right, stand by, John. I want to toss over to Shepherd Smith, who is live in Rome, where all the action is, which is so exciting. And he's got Father Jonathan Morris with him now. Hey, Shep.
Indeed, Megan. Thanks so much. You know, one thing, we know a little bit about what they were planning to do at this time. As they did back in 2005. First, there's a time for prayer and reflection. They have to get the vestments right. The papal tailor has made three different sizes of vestments, depending on who this may be, small, medium, and large, as they call it. And there'll be some adjustments necessary. So that'll have to happen. They'll have to get everybody lined up, and eventually they'll come to the window, to the balcony. And it's my understanding, our guidance from the Vatican is that the time between the smoke rising and the time they think they'll probably come out on the balcony is somewhere around 45 minutes. They're asking that you don't hold them to that too closely, but somewhere around 45 minutes. So after they get the vestments right, out to the balcony they'll come, and in Italian they will say, I announce to you a great joy. Father Jonathan Morris, a Fox News contributor, a Catholic priest with us here as he was back in 2005. Wow.
You know, as soon as I saw white smoke, I got peaceful. You know, I've been anxious up till now because it's an exciting time, and it's also a time of great weight and of great importance. But now, just as those people in the square are screaming, Viva il Papa, without knowing who that Papa is, likewise, we recognize that we don't need a perfect pope. Jesus chose Peter, and it turned out he wasn't so perfect. After all, he denied him three times when he needed him most. But we will have somebody who is there as Vicar of Christ, in other words, a representative for us and the leader of the church. Extremely exciting times, and to know that a person with a history that comes from a family who has a mother and a father and brothers and sisters is going to walk out of that balcony and be the next pope. Unbelievable.
Enormous challenges ahead. Those are for another day. Tonight is for a celebration of hope and faith and love. And when you look at these pictures in the crowd, I want you to understand what it's like out here tonight. It's 25 minutes after 7 o'clock in the evening. Most of these people have been here since about 4 o'clock, some as late as 4:30, 4:45 this afternoon, when it was about 52 degrees and raining. Since then, it has rained and rained and rained, and it's now 46 degrees. It's windy and really, really damp and cold. And we have a tent over our heads on a seventh floor balcony. They have umbrellas. It is still raining. They don't feel their toes, I'm positive, because I haven't felt my toes in hours. And yet they jump around with an excitement that is not unexpected, but my goodness, they've been through a lot today.
Shep, I bet the Pope, the new Pope, doesn't feel his toes either at this point. You know, they take him into what's called a room of tears, in which they ask him, do you accept? And he has to make a choice. At that point, I think anybody who wouldn't want to accept would have already said that he wasn't a candidate. But yes, it's an amazing time for him, too.
Father's song has broken. Let's listen. It's hard to make out what they're saying, even if you do speak the language. But I know one thing they're saying is, we can't wait to meet the Pope.
Yeah, that's right. And I've been in that square many times. I do speak Italian. And the reason why you can't understand it is because there are groups from all over the world, and they're singing all sorts of languages, doing it in their own way. And that's a picture of the church that is so many different ethnicities, so many different even views on different issues within the church. And there they are rejoicing in the fact that someone has been elected, even though they don't know who it is.
You've seen flags from so many countries out there. 2 days ago, we were in the middle of here, Rome, the wettest and the worst weather for a March in 21 years, according to the local forecasters. Tourism has been very low. The economy has been very bad. And all of a sudden, yesterday and today, people from all over Europe have streamed into this capital, and it is alive and vibrant even in the rain.
It is, Shep. And to think that all those people have had the experience of a lifetime in this moment of history. You know, I'm also just trying to go in my own mind of what the Pope is doing right now. And another thing that that we know he's doing, he's standing there in front of all the cardinals, and they come up one by one, and they make a promise of fidelity, of loyalty to him, just as former Pope Benedict did. As he was leaving, he said, among you, 115 is the new Pope, and I promise my loyalty and obedience to you. All of those other candidates who have not been chosen go single file, and they come up to him, and they promise their loyalty and fidelity, an act of humility.
There's a lot of pomp and circumstance, a lot of spiritual activities that happen tonight, but at some point the new Pope will have been elected and the crowds will disperse. What then?
Well, the Pope stays in the Santa Marta residence for a few days, probably up until the installation mass. So he goes back. He has an option to switch rooms from his normal cardinal room into a bigger Pope room within Santa Marta residence. Pope Benedict decided to stay within his own room during those few days before he moves into the Papal Palace, just because he didn't want to pack up his bags and go to the room next door. There's no need to. But that's what the Pope will be doing. He'll go back and he will stay within. He'll get caught up then on the responsibilities of his new job, which will include the installation mass, which could happen as early as later this week or perhaps at the beginning of next.
Wow. A lot to be done tonight. And soon we'll find out who the Pope is. Is it Cardinal Scola from Milan, a man seen as a reformer, or Cardinal Scherer from Brazil, a man seen as more of an insider but certainly a favorite around here, or one of the other 113? Megan, I think we're probably just about 15 minutes or so away from knowing.
The anticipation is building everywhere as we wait to hear the name. Now we know someone's been chosen, and we wait to find out who. Shepard, back to you in a moment. Here in New York, we want to talk to Tom Peterson. He's founder and president of Catholics Come Home. As we watch the crowds continue to cheer, at times it is a deafening roar coming from St. Peter's Square, and it has not let up, I should point out. From the moment we first saw the white smoke moments ago, Tom, when the smoke first came out, I said it looks gray. We didn't want to get ahead of ourselves. It didn't look black. It didn't look pure white. But once it got going, it was clear that it was white smoke and that we do, in fact, have a new Pope. Your thoughts?
Well, the saying goes, if it's black smoke, no Pope. White smoke, there is a Pope. And if it's gray, they didn't know how to use the furnace properly. But we're... We praise God that we have a new pope. It's exciting to see how the world is so jubilant about this vicar of Christ. And at a time when people wonder if people care about faith anymore or religion, this gives us a precursor to heaven. How jubilant and excited we can be if we're faithful Christians and we're focused on Jesus and we get this jubilant party in heaven someday. So I thank God for the Vicar of Christ who represents the Catholic Church and Christianity worldwide, who tries to bring and sow peace around the world and change the world for the better. Praise God for this historic moment.
You know, it's a good point because you see and hear so much about growing secularism, especially in the news business, I can tell you. And much less so do we focus on moments like this, moments of faith, where people celebrate their faith and their connection to God and see a square full of thousands of people doing exactly that. As you know, millions and perhaps more than a billion more around the globe are doing privately right now.
Well, Megan, we've seen incredible things where hundreds of thousands of people have come home to the church based on a Catholics Come Home television commercial inviting them in their local diocese or on national TV. How much more exciting it is that this is going worldwide to invite millions of people back home to Jesus and his church. This is a jubilant time in our history and a time for us to all reflect on how can we grow closer to Christ and how can we be better to our neighbors.
Absolutely.
This is exactly what the world is all about.
Stand by, if you would, Tom, for 1 second. I want to bring back in John Moody, author of Pope John Paul II, a biography, and our executive VP of news here. What are we seeing here, John?
That seems to be the Swiss Guard moving out. They, of course, are the symbolic bodyguard of the Holy Father. And it looks to me as though they're getting into position for the next part of the ceremony, which, of course, will be the revelation of who the next pope is.
So they're getting close. And is it a situation where there would be a staging area behind the scenes where the new pope would be now wearing his new papal vestments and be waiting to come out?
Well, yes, I think, as somebody else was saying, it's the Room of Tears, and I'm sure it was given that name for a very good reason. There must be raging emotions going on inside that man right now, whoever he is. He has to pick between a small, medium, and large set of vestments that have been made for him by the papal tailor. And after that, he again comes back out and meets what were his brother cardinals and are now his subordinate cardinals.
And this balcony that we see and we'll show it to you again. This is where the newly elected pope will come out and address the crowd.
Yes, you'll have the Camerlengo, the leading cardinal. Come out and say Habemus Papam. And
so don't get confused. The first person to come out on the balcony is not the newly elected pope.
That's right. And he will say Habemus Papam, we have a pope. And then he will read out the name in Latin. First of all, the cardinal's name in Latin.
Just to make sure we're thoroughly confused.
And then he will say who will rule as, and then he'll give the choice that the new Holy Father has made.
And some of us may know the new pope upon sight. If it's one of the front runners, we may know. But as you were pointing out a moment ago, it's happened in the not too distant past where people said, who is that? Who is that guy? People thrumming through their brain room briefing book saying, that doesn't look familiar.
It's the Italian version of what did he say? yes, absolutely. So you know, there are 115 possibilities, and I don't think anybody who's not a very close follower of these things would say that he knows every single face.
Now, you're a newsman, I'm a newswoman, and we're both Catholics. But so this question is appropriate from me to you. Are there ever any leaks? Is there any chance we're going to find this out moments before he steps on the balcony?
You know, I don't think that'll be the case. I believe that they installed a pretty effective jamming system for any kind of mobile devices. I believe Joan Lewis, actually, of EWTN, was saying that her own apartment, which is nearby, has also been affected by this.
Wow.
So it works. You know, it would be so improper and so out of character for something this joyful and this holy, if you will, to try to ruin it like that. I just can't think of who would do that.
And will there be a coalescence behind the new pope, no matter who he is? If it's not somebody who is known as a pro-reformist, if it is somebody who is on the inside of the Curia, the others will get behind him as if they had always had been, will they not?
They will certainly profess their allegiance to him, and they will try to do their best. The Catholic Church, in addition to being a pathway to heaven, as we believe, is also an institution, and there are rivalries and grudges and people that don't get along.
Let's take a listen to St. Peter's Square.
Thank you.
As we heard moments ago, the crowd chanting Viva il Papa, live the Pope. They are anticipating the announcement, as are we. And John, there's John Moody still with me. There is nothing to do but wait right now for the revelation of the identity of the man we now know will be the 266th Pope.
It's just a time when you have to wait and see what God has decided for the church. I'm struck, though, Megan, by those faces in the crowd. We talked about it earlier. And you just hope that after so many problems that the Vatican has endured over the past years, that this is the face of Catholicism that can be sustained during the next papacy. Happy, expectant, hopeful.
And it is a new beginning. That's as these things always are. It's a chance for renewal and a new start. For the Catholic Church on so many fronts, because it has had a lot of scandal, it's had a lot of problems, but it's also brought joy and blessings and goodness to billions of people around the world.
And that really is the purpose of the Church, to go out and help your fellow human being. And again, I know that whatever choice the cardinals and God have made, this new Pope is going to dedicate himself to exactly that task.
As you watch the folks in the crowd with the joy and the smiles, and it's almost got a rock concert feel, as I mentioned earlier. And it's something that even people who are not faithful, who don't consider themselves religious, can relate to, because that shared experience of being together as a group and rooting for something or being joyful about something or mourning something. Even some of the non-faithful went into church after Newtown, for example, and sat together and held one another and felt that connection to their fellow human beings. We're seeing just another form of that in some ways right here.
Well, that's right. Being together with other human beings is an essential part of humanity. And whether it's a sad occasion, as you mentioned, Newtown, or this, which is a very hopeful, anticipatory, expectant occasion, you want to share it with somebody else, and you want to say, I was there then, and somebody says, so was I. What did you think?
And we don't know when this will happen again. One of the goals, they said, in picking this Pope would be to hopefully pick a younger man. None of them are that young, the cardinals who are up for it, but on the younger side, so that we'll have this Pope for years to come. So it could be, 10, 20 years before we go through this again, John.
That's a possibility. There's another school of thought, and I, of course, don't have any insights into it, that what they want is someone who can come in, clean out the curia, which is what so many people think needs to be done, clean out the administration of the church, get it back on sound fiscal, financial, and moral footing, and perhaps not have a long papacy, and then pass it on to a younger man who might be another John Paul II.
Is there a thought of, were there candidates who were believed to have the ability to multitask on that front?
Well, I think that they have talked about managerial popes, and that is probably very delicately coded language for going in and cleaning house. And then there are others who certainly have had more pastoral experience, have been out in the world, seen the face of real suffering, seen the face of real people, and tried to do good and be a pastoral pope.
Knowing what you know about the Catholic Church and about these cardinals, does history tell us anything about which way they likely went? Not asking you to choose a name, but just in terms of direction.
Megan, I think the thing that we all forget, since we're not the 115 people in there, is that so much of it comes from prayer, reflection, trying to discern what God is telling them to do. The things that we think and the things that we write about and broadcast about may have very little to do with what's going on in their minds.
Mm-hmm. It has been about 35 minutes since we saw the puff of white smoke coming out of the chimney. We are told it will take about that time. We were told 40, 45 minutes perhaps at the most for what needs to happen inside the Vatican to happen before we see the new Pope emerge right there before your eyes on that balcony. Again, just to refresh you, the first person who will come out will not be the new Pope. It will be the person who will be announcing the new Pope, the proto-deacon. He's basically the master of ceremonies, 69-year-old French cardinal Jean-Louis Taron. Now, if it is not the 69-year-old French cardinal who emerges, Jean-Louis Taron, then we can assume he is the Pope. But we believe that he hasn't been mentioned as one of the front runners, so we believe he will be the first one to emerge to make the announcements in Latin, Habemus Papam, we have a Pope, and then we'll introduce the new Pope to the world in Latin, and hopefully we will recognize that person upon sight, although it is not entirely clear whether we will. And it's funny, John, these popes, obviously, in the Catholic Church are not allowed to marry, but they have families and they have loved ones, and those people, too, are watching right now, wondering whether their loved one is about to emerge on the balcony.
Well, that's right. I mean, the anticipation for family members, for mothers, sisters, cousins must just be unbearable. I mean, is it possibly him? I believe we heard yesterday that the mother of Cardinal Schönborn, the Austrian, said he can't be Pope. He's too good-natured. He's too nice.
Right. Exactly. And, you know, I'm struck by the image that we had moments before this one of a nun holding the rosary. It's just a small sign that so many of us use and our loved ones use to remind us of our closeness to God and to pray. And it's something you do in your living room. I mean, I think of my 97-year-old Nana, who always has that on her and uses it to get through everything. And that's a symbol of faith and what it means to pray and to believe in God and to be a Catholic. And this is the embodiment of all of that.
Well, you're Nana, and me too. I've got mine with me right now. And it's just a symbol that brings us all together. And you know, you mentioned, Megan, the nun holding the rosary. I think it's going to be very interesting to see how this next pope decides to approach nuns, the women who have given their lives to a religious life. There's been a little bit of dispute, I think, recently with American nuns. I think now would be a perfect time for the new pope to say, sisters, we understand what you do for us and we thank you.
How hard is it to find, there we go, there it is, how hard is it, do you think, to find a cardinal like that who would become pope? I mean, when one thinks of the Catholic Church, one doesn't think of, you know, a progressive body, and I don't mean that in the sense of liberal. I just mean, you know, always forward-looking, always at the advanced edge. No, they're more traditional.
It will be difficult because none of these cardinals knows the hardships of being a sister, obviously. But they can appreciate the incredible devotion that these women bring to their job. And I think it would be an excellent sign. You know, Pope John Paul II took as his personal motto, Totus Tuum, and it was dedicated to the Blessed Virgin, all for you. Mm-hmm. And, I think a return to that kind of dignity and that recognition of service would be an excellent first step for this pope to take.
So now we are pushing towards 40 minutes since the white smoke, so we should be getting there, folks, any minute. And you can see that the pomp and circumstance that the Catholics do so well has quieted down a bit outside of the Vatican. And so they clearly believe that something's going to happen. John was telling me they do practice, because you saw how well executed the performances were and sort of the protocol was executed, and yet they do get to practice, although they apparently do it off-site. So they, even though this doesn't happen very often, they know what they're doing. As we continue to await the actual announcement, I want to check in with our own Shepherd Smith, who is live in Rome and has a guest with him, Father Gerald Murray. Shepherd?
Indeed. Megan, thanks so much. The smoke issued forth at 7:07 in Vatican City, so we're a little bit over time, and we anticipate that this will begin in just a moment. Father, it's so nice to see you tonight. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Shep.
There are a lot of little things that have to be done. There's a time for prayer. They have to get the vestments just right. And the big moment is coming. What are you expecting to hear from the cardinal who is now pope?
Well, this is the moment when he makes his first greeting to the world and to the church. And I'm sure he's going to throw his arms out widely and welcome the people and tell them that he is now their father. He is the shepherd of the church. He's the father of all believers, and he's here to guide them to Christ. And he's going to ask for their prayers, I'm sure.
In 78, a bit of self-deprecating humor we had from Pope John Paul II. And then in 2005, Cardinal Ratzinger was sort of widely expected, and people got sort of exactly what they thought, I think. Tonight, a great anticipation and a lot of wonder.
It is, and we've been hearing names. We're going to see if any of those prognostications were correct. But the great thing about the church is once you see the pope, everyone embraces him. And I'm sure he's going to make a wonderful impression on us all.
In your estimation, the first thing that would be good for this pope to do, beyond the embrace, which is no doubt about to happen, the next order for the church and for the followers?
Well, I think he has to reaffirm in the minds of the believers that believing in God and following his path is worth giving your life to. In other words, reaffirm the religious mission. And then secondly, tell people that the love of Christ is not limited simply to believers, that we have to go out and bring that love to the world. And that takes form in acts of charity, but also in preaching the faith, being a missionary.
At this point, the church is hoping to bring in more people from around the world with this mission of love and hope and charity. This cardinal now Pope will be charged with doing just that. It begins right here in St. Peter's Square on a cold, rainy night.
That's right, and the rain is not going to dampen the emotions tonight. I think we're going to see a Pope who people are going to immediately embrace, and then the message he gives will be very important, and I think it will be a message of faith, and as you say, we have to expand the circle of God's love in the world.
The bells began to ring at 19:08 tonight, 8 minutes after 7, and within 3 or 4 minutes, we were able to look down from the balcony where we stand, and people were coming. Every street was filling. People running with raincoats on, some without, some carrying children, cars honking, and filling the entire area around Vatican City. People were coming out of their homes in Rome to run to this place, to witness this moment.
Yes, I was looking out from the hotel where I'm staying, and windows are open, people looking out, they want to hear the bells. Yeah, this is one of those rare events in human history. The providence of God has given us a new Pope, and people want to be part of that first greeting and first blessing which the Pope will give from the Loggia.
Do we know tonight, just out of curiosity, where Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI is? And is he watching? With whom is he?
Yeah, so he is out at Castel Gandolfo, which is the papal summer residence, and he is watching on TV. The report was that he was following the conclave on television.
Never in 600 years has a Pope witnessed the inauguration or the electing of a Pope. It's astounding.
We live in unusual times, but unusual blessings, too, I think, are coming to us. Yeah, the former Pope, Pope Benedict XVI, he already said that he pledges his loyalty and reverence to the new Pope. So he's sort of the first in line to instruct us on how to greet our new Pope.
Well, you may hear, Viva Papa, long live the Pope. The thousands upon thousands who don't yet know who the Pope is, hoping for long life. Yeah, one of the things that they had said in advance that they hoped for was a youthful man. They're trying to attract young people. The young people are the heart and soul and vibrance of the church, and hoping to bring in more young people. A younger man was the thought last time among a bunch of people, and this time as well.
Yes, and I wouldn't be surprised if we do see a younger man coming out on that balcony. And it's true, the youth of the world are the future of the church. So that's what we're looking to inspire.
It's 3 o'clock on the East Coast, noon on the West Coast, 8 p.m. in Rome and in Vatican City. I'm Shepard Smith, and this is Fox News continuing coverage of the inauguration of the next Pope, the next leader of the Roman Catholic Church. 1.2 billion Catholics around the world, so many of them at this moment are, as you are, watching a television set on continent after continent, waiting on this cold night in Rome for the word to spread. We have a Pope. We learned of that a Pope had been elected exactly 53 minutes ago now. The guidance from the Vatican, from the Holy See, was that the process would take about 45 minutes. For those of you just joining us, there was a time for prayer, some greetings, fitting of the vestments, the choirs have sung and the bands have played, and the people have arrived. And now waiting for that moment when we learn who of the 115 who went into the Sistine Chapel as a cardinal will come out as the leader of the faithful. Gerald Murray is with us from Holy Family Church in Manhattan and in New York City, and is here with us watching this. Amy Kellogg called it an interregnum period of great suspense. That has ended, but the suspense has not. They know, but we don't.
Yes, the cardinals are all smiling inside the Vatican, but soon, when the new Pope comes out, we'll all share that joy, and I think that square is going to explode in cheers, and you can hear all the sirens and the cars. Rome is going to go crazy tonight.
One thing I've learned in my limited time in Rome for the covering of the two inaugurations of popes and a little bit of vacation time is sirens are ubiquitous. It's possible that this is out of celebration, but they are always here, morning, noon, and night. And I love Rome, but right, those noises are beyond annoying.
Yeah, I lived here for 4 years in the 90s, and you have to get used to that, exactly.
It takes time. To look out over this crowd and see so many people with so many different flags from all over Europe and around the world. It's not as if this city has been teeming with tourists. It's my guess and it's my understanding from watching the local news and reading the local newspapers that people have streamed in here over the past day to witness this moment.
That's right, Shep, and that's very natural at this time because we've had the preparatory meetings in a couple of weeks before the Pope actually resigned, so people got ready for this. But on the other hand, I've also met people who are here just to make a regular pilgrimage, student groups, and they're here by coincidence, but everybody's in the square now.
Mm. You know, the biggest difference from my living it between this time and the last time is, of course, there was no period of mourning. No one has died. And on top of that, the last time, people of Poland descended upon this place. They slept by the thousands in the street. It was inspiring, the reverence, the calm, the respect that was given. This has been a completely different scene. It building towards something that you know, no one had ever experienced.
Yes, and it was very unexpected that the Pope would resign, and I don't think people had in mind that there'd be a conclave coming up so soon, but people are coming into the city, and it's going to be an interesting experience. And when we find out who it is, then we'll see a lot of pilgrims will try to get here in time for the first inaugural Mass of the Pope, the inaugural Mass, I should say. And if it's an Italian, believe me, this nation's going to be very, very happy.
And my guess, it is our understanding that this will happen on Sunday, but it's possible that it could be the Tuesday after. They'll let us know.
Right, and Tuesday is St. Joseph Day, who
exactly.
Was a patron of Italy and a very revered saint in the Italian church.
Father, stay with us. Waiting for the big moment, we have a new pope, Megyn Kelly. It's exciting.
It is, and we waited not too long, Shepherd, but on the fifth vote, they managed to come up with the 77 votes that were required in order to find the new pope. We don't know what the final number is, but John Moody is saying it may leak out in the days and weeks to come. It may not. We do know, however, they have a two-thirds agreement among the 115 cardinals who are eligible to vote. Tom Peterson is the founder and president of Catholics Come Home, and he's been watching these events with us. Tom, the procession outside of the Basilica has ended. I mean, the music has stopped, and the guards have stopped. And now we wait. What do you imagine is happening inside?
Oh, I imagine they're getting everybody ready to announce the new Vicar of Christ to the world and how exciting that is. I just wrote a book called Catholics Come Home, God's Extraordinary Plan for Your Life. Little did this young man years ago know that he would become not only a priest, but would become Pope. What an extraordinary plan God had for his life. And this reminds us that God has an extraordinary plan for all of our lives, that each one of us has a certain role to play in this thing we call life. And here in a few moments, we're going to see the new Vicar of Christ coming out to play his role in life as a shepherd of the faithful.
And which we're keeping an eye on the balcony. We don't see any action yet, but occasionally you hear crowds, the crowd cheer. We're not privy to exactly all that they are cheering about, but we can see on that balcony so far, nothing again. Additional lights went on, we're being told. All right, so perhaps they're lighting the balcony so we can all get a better look. Moments ago, we did see some large screens in the crowd, so we believe they are helping the crowd get a better look at the balcony, and they appear to be getting ready for their next move. Let's sit and watch it for a minute. continue to watch and wait. And John Moody, as we watch, one of the first things the new Pope will tell us is the name that he has chosen to go by. The significance of that?
Very significant, Megan. Pope John Paul I, Cardinal Albino, when he was elected, took the names of his two predecessors, John the 23rd and Paul the 6th, which was a sign of continuity. He wanted to continue their policies. John Paul II, of course, with characteristic modesty, took the same name to say, I'm no different than what John Paul I would have done. That turned out not to be the case. He put on a little rock star show for 20 or so years. Pope Benedict, when he took his name, was doing it in honor of Pope Benedict the 15th, whose mission was to try to reunify Europe under a Christian banner. One could say that Pope Benedict the 16th either failed or didn't have enough time to take that to the fulfillment, but that was why he chose Benedict.
So it tells us a lot, the name they've chosen for themselves. They are trying to telegraph to the Catholics worldwide what type of a leader they will be.
To Catholics worldwide, and very much so to their other cardinals.
Is that right? This is what we're told is going to happen momentarily, by the way, folks, after the protodeacon comes out and announces the Pope. The new Pope, we're told, will likely give greetings in several languages, and then will speak in his native language, or perhaps in Italian. John and I were discussing earlier about how Pope John Paul II came out and struggled a bit with his Italian, but it only made the crowd love him more, and said to the cheers, if I make a mistake, you will correct me. And everyone loved him. So we'll see what the Pope's native language is and whether he chooses to go to it. It could be Italian. One of the front runners is from Milan. After that, the new Pope will be expected to celebrate Mass with the Cardinals in the Sistine Chapels on the day following his election. That will not be open to the public, but it will be an important part of this process. And then, John, the Cardinals will go back home. And do they go back home to their respective countries and cities with a mandate from the new Pope, or does that come later?
I think very much they go back with a mandate. They will be expected to pass along the message that he has given to them. If this new Pope comes out and says, you know, I want you to go forth and evangelize and bring more Catholics into our flock, you can bet that evangelization will be the new buzzword. If he comes back and says it's time for humility, I think we all need to reflect on the sins of the past, that's something that the Cardinals will be talking about. He's definitely going to give them a mandate as they go back to their parishes and archdioceses.
Speak, if you can, about the support that the new Pope will have. I mean, even though he's going to be the leader of the Catholic Church, he's just a man, and he needs help, and he needs assistance, and he needs input from others. How does he create that group around him?
I certainly don't want to compare it in any way, but it's I think American viewers would understand that when a new president is elected, the whole country for a while is behind him. They say, yes, you're our new leader. We want to get along with you. We want you to lead us somewhere. This, of course, is a worldwide office, and one could say a heavenly office. But the new Pope comes with a tremendous amount of goodwill behind him, from the cardinals, from all the bishops around the world, and let us hope from the 1.2 billion Catholics. But he's got to earn it, and that's what the first couple of weeks and months of this new papacy will tell us.
So in terms of advice and counsel, he'll lean on his fellow cardinals, on bishops, on others within the church, or will it be something like they take their staff that was assisting them as cardinals, and those are the people who they've trusted for years, and those are the people who will become now the ones who have the ear of the new Pope?
It's a little bit of both, but mostly the latter. Every one of these cardinals has come in with staff, probably from his home archdiocese. It's well known that John Paul II came in with a bunch of Polish aides, and they suddenly called it the Polish Vatican once he got there.
And look at that. I love the close-up shot of the balcony windows. We all want to peek behind those curtains, don't we? You can see some figures moving about somewhat behind the curtains, but what we need is for them to open up the doors, and we may be pretty close to that. This is the first time. This is a pool camera shot we're getting back, and this is the first we have seen something like this. Let's watch.
Annuncio vobis gaudium magnum. Avenus Papam. Eminentissimum, accredentissimum Dominum,
and most reverend
George
Marius,
Ecclesia,
Cardinal of the Holy Roman Church, Bergoglio, who takes for himself the name of Francis.
Franciscum.
He's from Argentina. He's a Latin American pope, George Mario Bergoglio.
Habemus Papam, we have a new pope. And that new pope is not one of the names that we had heard that much, Bergoglio of Argentina. It is a man whose father, we're told, was an Italian rail worker. Shepherd Smith live in Rome with more on the new pope and his identity.
Megan, he was on our watch list and had been from the very beginning. He is a man of the people. As our guests here have explained, he's the man who rides the bus. He was second the last time around. That was the belief. And now we know.
They made a serious choice. This man is a man of the people. It means the entire Latin American world has a pope who speaks Spanish. It means a man who rides the bus and not stays in his mansion. It's a man who is in solidarity with the poor people of the world.
An ordinary for Eastern Rite faithful in Argentina who lack the ordinary of their own right. Born on December the 17th, 1936, making him 76 years old. Born in Buenos Aires. He was ordained for the Jesuits on December the 13th, 1969, during his theological studies at the theological facility at San Miguel. He was a novice master at San Miguel, where he also taught theology, was provincial for Argentina, the rector of the philosophical and theological faculty in San Miguel, and after completing his doctoral dissertation in Germany, he served as a confessor, spiritual director in Cordoba. In May of 92, he was elected the titular bishop of Acua, an auxiliary of Buenos Aires, but the long and short of it is, they've decided to go with a reformer?
This man is a strong man. He's his own man. I think the key thing about him is he is nobody's puppet. He's not anyone's in anyone's pocket.
The thinking going into this is that they would choose someone who is of the curia, of the administration, if you will, an insider, or someone from the outside. And if those are the two categories, he fits into neither.
He's a saint. He's a holy man. He's a Jesuit. And this is the first time in centuries, I don't know that I have to check this, if there's been another Jesuit pope, but he's well educated, he's got a powerful mind, and he's a very humble and steady man. I think that's the key thing about him.
What does this mean for Latin America and for the church in Latin America? This is a development for which so many in Latin America have prayed.
This means the entire world can rejoice that the half of the world's Catholic population has produced a man who will lead the church, who will be Peter. And this is the thing I think is important to remember. The man has three names. He's born with his baptismal name, in this case, Jorge. And then he's going to come out and tell us what his name is going to be as Pope. And he may very well choose Benedict the 17th, or he might choose Leo the 14th. We'll hear that in just a moment. But he's also going to be Peter. And in this sense, he will be the successor of Benedict, and he will be the successor of Peter.
Cardinal Jorge Mario Bergoglio, Archbishop of Buenos Aires, in Argentina, the next pope?
Well, I was in the press office this afternoon, and I watched some of the guys in the Italian putting up their profiles, and I saw Bergoglio on two screens.
Well, there'd been a great deal of speculation, of course, and enormous anticipation, and I believe hope among so many that the largest percentage of the population within the church today might someday be represented, and at long last, they will be.
This man is a good man. He is not a man who puts on airs. As I said, he rides the bus. He's an intelligent man. I think it's a wonderful choice.
He served as president of the Bishops' Conference in Argentina in 2005. He was created and proclaimed cardinal by John Paul II at a consistory of 21st February 2001. So he's been a cardinal now for 12 years.
Yes. The one surprise is that he's a little older. He's 76. But in a way, I think this is a good choice because a younger man wouldn't have the experience. I think they tried to square the circle here. Instead of leaping right now to a young man, they went to a holy man, a man who's gone through life, a little bit older and more experienced. He can be a real father.
He was not a wealthy man. He grew up as, I don't know, a commoner.
As an ordinary person. But then he distinguished himself by his studies. And that's, in a sense, he lifted himself by his own study and virtue to the position that he's now going to be taking.
Do you know if he speaks Italian?
Oh, sure. He speaks excellent Italian.
And given all that you know about him and have read about him, what might you anticipate his demeanor and his message would be as the curtains open again and we meet for the first time the Holy Father?
The serenity of the knowledge that we still always have faith, hope, and love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. He'll probably quote St. Paul.
I wonder, your estimation, of the tens of thousands, I have no idea exactly how many, of people who have come here today, how many will know who he is when they see him?
You know, it is a slightly unusual choice. We knew that he was one of the candidates in the last papal election, where Benedict XVI was elected. We put him in the second rank this time around because we thought they would probably go for a younger man, and we had all the other candidates were a bit younger. But I think they chose a steady man, but I think they really felt the sparkle of this man's heart. I think we're going to find a man with a big heart.
I wonder, enormous Catholic population in Buenos Aires. I can't even imagine what it's like there at this moment.
Well, I don't know. In Buenos Aires, I'm sure they're feeling delight and joy.
Well, it's now been the better part of an hour and 15 minutes since the smoke rose, and now I see the curtains moving again.
There he is.
And here he comes.
There's Sodano.
And we'll see him on this feed in just a moment. In just a second, you'll see him, and away we go. I can't wait to hear his voice. You've heard him speak before.
Yes, I have.
And to give us an idea of what we can expect.
I would concentrate on the fact that this man is humble, but he's very intelligent, very accomplished, learned man. He understands the world, but he's extremely humble. He doesn't put himself first. He's a servant.
The primary objective of the Catholic Church is to spread the gospel, to spread the word of God.
Yeah.
Would you anticipate, given what you know about his health, that he would be a pope who would travel a great deal, one who would go back to his homeland, who would go to Latin America and try to bring in the faithful?
Well, I'm not sure that the traveling... Look, the curtains are moving now. I don't know that they're going to be sending the Pope traveling as much as John Paul II. I think they don't need to do that with the internet.
I believe history is upon us. Let's listen.
Fratelli e sorelle, buonasera. Voi sapete?
You know that the duty of the conclave was to give Rome a bishop.
Era di dare un vescovo a Roma.
It looks like my brothers, the cardinals, went to find him at the end of the world almost. But here we are.
Ma siamo qui.
I thank you for your warm welcome.
Vi ringrazio l'accoglienza.
The Rome Diocese
La comunità
now
diocesana
has
a Roma,
its bishop. Thank you.
Grazie. E prima di tutto,
first of all,
prima di tutto,
I wish to
vorrei
dedicate
fare una preghiera
a prayer to our
Pope Emeritus,
Benedict XVI. We all together want to pray for him so that the Lord may bless him and Mary may hold him. And now there's the Our Father.
Venga il tuo regno, sia fatta la tua volontà, come in cielo così in terra. Dacci oggi il nostro pane quotidiano, rimetti a noi i nostri debiti, come noi lo rimettiamo ai nostri debitori, e non ci indurre in tentazione, ma liberaci dal male. Ave Maria, piena di grazia,
the Holy Mary,
con ti, ben sei benedetta tra le donne, e benedetto il frutto del tuo seno, Gesù. Santa Maria, Madre di Dio, prega per noi peccatori, adesso è l'ora della nostra morte. Amen. Gloria al Padre e al Figlio e
glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Principio e ora e sempre,
nei secoli dei secoli. Amen.
E adesso incominciamo questo cammino, vescovo e popolo.
Let's begin this path, the bishop with its people, this path of the Church of Rome, which is the church that presides over all the other churches in love, the path of brotherhood, of love, and of faith and trust. Let's always pray for each other. Let's pray for the entire world.
Perché ci sia una grande fratellanza.
So that there can be a great brotherhood.
Vi auguro che questo cammino di chiesa
that this path within the church
che oggi incominciamo
that we are starting today
il mio cardinale vicario
and my
presente,
vicar cardinal who's next to me will definitely help me.
Per la
we want for it to be fruitful for the
città.
Evangelization of this beautiful city.
Adesso vorrei dare la benedizione, ma prima
and
vi
now
chiedo un
I would
favore.
Love to give you my
prima
blessing, but before I want to ask you
popolo,
a favor. Before the bishop blesses the people, I want for you
al Signore perché
to
mi benedica,
pray
la preghiera
the
del
Lord
popolo,
so that he can bless
chiedendo
me.
La benedizione per
so
il suo vescovo.
I want for the people to ask
Facciamo
the Lord for blessing for its bishop.
Facciamo in silenzio
so, let's,
questa preghiera di voi su di me.
For this prayer from you for me.
Santo Padre Francesco,
Francis, to all the faithful present here and all those who receive this blessing via radio or television, and the new communication technologies gives the plenary indulgence in the form established by the Church. Let's pray God the Almighty so that he can keep the Pope for many years at the leadership of the Church, and for him to give peace and unity to the Church all over the world. And now I will give you my blessing all over the world to all the men and women of good will.
Santi Apostolis Petrus et Paulus.
May the holy apostles Peter and Paul, in whose power and authority we have confidence, intercede on our behalf to the Lord. Amen. Through the prayers of merits of the Blessed Mary Ever Virgin, Blessed Michael the Archangel, Blessed John the Baptist, and of the holy apostles Peter and Paul, and of all the saints, may the Almighty God have mercy on you, and with your sins forgiven, may Jesus Christ lead you into everlasting life. Amen.
Indulgentiam, absolutionem et remissionem omnium peccatorum vestrorum.
May the Almighty and the merciful Lord grant you indulgence, absolution, and remission of all your sins, time for true and fruitful penance, an always repentant heart, an amendment of life, the grace and consolation of the Holy Spirit, and final perseverance in good works. Amen. And may the blessing of the Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend on you and remain with you always. Amen.
Sisters,
thank you very much for your warm welcome.
pray for me. And see you soon. I'll see you soon. Tomorrow I'll go pray the Holy Mary so that she can watch over the whole of Rome.
Buonanotte e buon riposo.
Good night and please rest.
He will be known as Pope Francis, formerly Cardinal Jorge Bergoglio of Argentina. And John Moody is still with me here as we watch these events and had an interesting observation among many others, John, which you, when you listened to him, you said this is all code for humility.
Yes.
Your thoughts?
He chose the name Francis in deference to Saint Francis, one of the most humble of the saints in the Catholic Church. He bowed to accept the blessings of the crowd and to ask for God's blessings. I have never heard Rome that quiet before in my life. And he asked for help from the people. This is a man who's going to be a pope of the people, and I believe that it will be the mark of his papacy that he started it off this way. No one will ever forget this moment.
You talked before we knew his identity about the possibility of going with someone who was a little older. He is 76 years old, perhaps to come in and sort of fix things and then pass the baton. Is that what's happened here?
It's a possibility. I think that they've picked Pope Francis because of who he is, not because of who he is not. However, it is very clear that they want someone who can take charge of the Vatican bureaucracy, which is called the Curia. Pope Francis has indicated in the past, when he was the Cardinal and Archbishop of Buenos Aires, that he thought there was a lot of room for improvement in the Curia. That made him popular at home, and it may have given hope to those who looked at him as a reformer once he took the throne of Peter.
What a man he is. As you look at his background and hear about how many times he rejected the trappings of power. Tell us more.
He's a Jesuit. He is not necessarily expected to be humble as a Jesuit, but he has very much shown that all through his career. As we mentioned earlier, he refuses to live in the Cardinal's palace. He takes the bus to work. He is mobbed by fans when he does so. He has always said that he is simply a man doing the will of God.
He does his own cooking.
He does his own cooking. He is very strong on the moral positions of the church and shows no yield, and yet he has gone to an AIDS hospice in Buenos Aires to wash the feet of AIDS victims.
He has been described as someone who is compassionate and conservative. They use those terms differently in the Catholic Church than we do politically in America, but as compassionate and conservative, and has been praised by some for holding the line against some attempts to assume more liberal positions in certain areas of the church. What does that mean, John?
It means that he's going to uphold the teachings of Christ as they've been given to him and as he's passed them on as a bishop and then a cardinal of the church. He does not believe that he, either as a cardinal or now as pope, has the authority to change what Jesus taught us to do. However, he is very concerned with the difference in economic prosperity between the richest and the poorest. He has spoken about that and said that there has to be some accommodation given to the poor. He has talked about the need to care about our poor brothers and sisters. Sometimes that gets him in trouble with more conservative wings, but in this case, I think we're going to see a pope who really reaches out right away to the poorest of the church and says, I am your brother, pray for me.
I want to bring in Shepherd Smith, who is live in Rome watching all of this happen and has been listening to our coverage as well right here, and to your thoughts, John. Shepherd?
Hi, Megan. Unbelievable. The first from the Americas in the millennium, with enormous ties to Italy, as hundreds of thousands of people have immigrated from Italy to Argentina. If there's anyone on earth who could bring together Italy and Latin America, it's this man. It's this man of the people. And from so many in our short time here in Rome, but years of covering this, we've heard We wish that the papacy could be more inclusive. We wish that the process could more include us. Father Jonathan Morris, if anyone could do that and has just done it, it's this man.
Well, notice, Shep, he walked out and was presented to the people without any notes whatsoever and just talked for a very good long time. And he looked at people. He didn't show off. He looked in a very quiet way, and then he began to talk, and he began to thank them for their welcome. And the fact that we have a pope that's from Argentina, from Latin America, and yet somebody who speaks Italian very well, who just spoke a very, very good Italian with an accent. You know, the Argentinians have a pretty strong accent, even in Spanish. But he was known, Shep, to be one who could come in and make some serious reform, because he was an outsider, and because he had done so in Argentina. The rumors were flying, and they were pretty much solid, that he was the runner-up eight years ago after Ratzinger, Pope Benedict XVI. And he went back to Argentina and was immediately elected as the president of the bishops' conference. It showed how much love he had garnered from his own people. He wasn't just a guy who had a lot of influence in the Vatican. No, his brother bishops in Argentina selected him to be their leader from 2005 up to 2011. Now he's going to go to the world, and he's going to show, I believe, the humility that John Moody explained very well as Francis.
History says he's done this throughout his life. He's gone to the faithful and said, the church needs you. He's now gone to Rome and to the world and said, I need your help. Please pray for me. And for the first time in our lifetimes, or any lifetimes about which we have any knowledge, he thanked the Pope Emeritus for all that he had done for the church. And he stood so quietly and humbly with his shoulders back and stood still and thanked the people. I can't imagine a more welcome gesture. And my guess is that Catholics throughout this city and this around this continent and around the world are rejoicing that they have a man who is clearly asking for them to be a part of the process.
He actually asked the people to pray over him. He bent down, put his hands down, not just giving the blessing to them, but please pray for me. That says a lot. It says a lot, and it's telling the curia as well, this is the way you reform. It's the change of the heart. It's the humility. It's not just management.
Megan, even the ubiquitous sirens stopped wailing as he bowed. I could tell you felt the moment there, and I think certainly everyone here did as well.
It was a beautiful thing to behold as you watched the emotion spread over the crowd, and you could feel it even here in the studio. And now the reports are coming in of the reaction from Argentina and how folks there burst into tears upon the news that their cardinal had been named Pope. I mean, you can imagine the pride and the overwhelming feeling of love they have for this man, as now do all the Catholics who are beholding this shepherd. And we'll get back to Shepherd momentarily, but I want to check back in with John Moody, who's been watching these proceedings with us. And you knew that this was a possibility. You had come out here and said, don't count this guy out. He was on the list of possibilities, but he wasn't one of the main guys that everybody was talking about. His age counted against him. He was second in line, though, last time. He lost to Cardinal Ratzinger, who became Pope Benedict. How much do you think that played into the decision today?
I think it was a face that they knew. I think it was a name that they trusted. And probably if he was second, I would never say he lost, but if he was second to Cardinal Ratzinger last time around, it's because he knew that that the church needed someone to hold its hand as it departed from John Paul II. And now this is the new era, a new age. I have to say, Megan, I'm so happy for my church right now. It has probably taken the biggest step in its history to reach out to the rest of the world and say, come join us. It's gone from the most impressive place in Rome, St. Peter's Basilica, to a working class neighborhood in Buenos Aires, where now Pope Francis came from, and said, we're all together in this. It's a wonderful moment for the church.
You talked about how humble he was and his humility. And he also took a moment to thank Pope Benedict. I mean, that was an important moment and another signal as well.
Again, a transition, again, something that it's not about me, it's about us. He thanking his predecessor, whose moral courage in giving up that office just cannot be overlooked. You don't give up the papacy easily. But Pope Benedict, former Pope Benedict, knew that it was time for him to let somebody else take the reins. He certainly has found a worthy successor.
Do you see this as a possible, you know, we talked about having a foot in both camps, as some of the other contenders did as well, somebody who could be a reformer but also carry on the traditions of the church, and, you know, sort of not, that believes in the fundamental doctrine of the church and that would advance it in a way that was consistent with tradition and history, while working on cleanup, while trying to focus on moving forward from some of the controversies that the Catholic Church has suffered through. Is this such a man?
Yes, it's exactly this kind of man. Cardinal Bergoglio, while he was still cardinal, was associated with a group called Communion and Liberation. This is a movement that grew out of the Second Vatican Council. It tried to make sure that the reforms of Vatican II didn't go too far and that the foundations of the church were not forgotten in the rush to modernize. So he'll build on his association with that group as he leads the church into a new era.
It'll be exciting to watch, and it'll be wonderful to see what the message is in Sunday Mass this weekend, and how his humility and his new messaging will translate to folks, you know, regular folks sitting in their Sunday church services just like they do every week, or in some cases
not so every week.
Not so every week. John Moody, thank you so much. You've been so helpful to us. Want to bring it back now, give it back now to Shepherd Smith, who is live in Rome. So lucky.
Oh, thank you, Megan. Let's get right down to Amy Kellogg, who's live in St. Peter's Square and was there to witness history before her eyes. Amy, how was it?
Well, we have a Pope, Shep, and we no longer have rain, but people are filing out of here, content that they were blessed by the new Pope, Pope Francis. It was a really extraordinary moment, Shep. I think people packed into this square before the white smoke rose. It was almost as if they all had some sort of spiritual tip-off, because normally they flood to St. Peter's Square after the bells start ringing and it's become known that the smoke was white. But they were here before the smoke went up, and then, of course, some additional people crowded into the square. You know, you talk about, obviously, a large number of people here, probably the majority are Italians, and there was a lot of talk that Italy would like to take back the papacy. But I think when it comes down to it, when you talk to the people who are truly religious, truly faithful, they wanted the Pope that was chosen by God. They wanted the Pope's choice to be inspired by the Holy Spirit, and I think that they believe that that's what happened and are as just as happy to see an Argentinian as they would have been.
Grande Baba!
Well, as they would have been to see another Italian, Shep. And I think there's also a sense that that the church is open. They're proud of the church that is based here in Rome, in the Vatican, of course, but in Italy, that is now even more inclusive. We've seen a Polish Pope, we've seen a German Pope, and now we have a Latin American Pope, which is particularly important given that Latin America has the biggest percentage of Catholics around the world. So it's quieting down a little bit here, despite some of the people shouting over my shoulder. People are going home, but the silence is, as John Moody pointed to, the silence that reigned over this square at the moment when Pope Francis came out onto the loggia was just mind-blowing, because it had been so rowdy and so happy and so festive here, and then there was silence and people praying along with the new and praying along with the new Pope, Shep.
Amy Kellogg, down the street in St. Peter's Square. Amy, thanks so much. We're lucky enough to be joined by Mario Bassetti now. Mario is a producer here for us at Fox News, works in our Rome Bureau, and is now covering his fifth Pope.
Yes.
Pope Francis, how do you feel about it?
I don't know much about the man, but I feel very good about it, yes.
They clearly made a decision.